Welcome back, everyone. I'm the Depressed Eeyore, and this is Kingdom Death Monster. Okay, let's go ahead and do our usual stuff. We need to get our endeavors. We have one, two people with Tinker, so we're gonna end up getting six endeavors again, which is fine, I guess. All right. We're about to lose half of them in a second, but we'll deal with that in a moment. First, let's pull up our settlement phase. Did all that. All right, settlement event. So 1d21 as always. Two. Okay. Clinging Mist. Okay. This is the event where you can potentially get New Game Plus. We can't get New Game Plus because we have the guidepost, so we don't have to. Well, I mean, it would be nice to go on a second hunt automatically, but unfortunately, we don't get that option. Anyway, the settlement is hidden behind a thick green mist. Something about the way the lantern light passes through it makes it seem alive. Roll 1d10. All right, so let's go ahead and roll 1d10 and see what happens. Seven. Does the settlement have ammonia? Yes. Nominate a survivor to douse themselves in urine and run through the settlement, clearing the mist away. They gain plus three understanding, but minus one permanent luck for being so gross. All right. So I guess the question is who do we want to get minus one luck? I'm thinking Mara. Whoever does this does get plus three understanding, which essentially means an immediate insight for that person. Do that or get a huge step towards White Secret. I don't really need White Secret right now, so I'm not that worried. I definitely don't want it on Momiji. And what minus one luck would be mean is if you have negative luck, you can't crit. Period. You can't crit at all. So it's either I put it on someone that has plus one luck and they become less of a useful crit person, such as Yumiko or Yorihime, or I put it on someone that I don't really intend on getting crits with or don't intend on using that much at the moment. Mara has a permanent debuff called where she has to hold onto that rock no matter what, so there's not much I can do about that. So you know what? Let's go ahead and give her minus one luck and she'll get Tinker. And let's go ahead and roll 1d10 for her insight and see what we get out of it. Eight. All right, story events. Insight. Eight is plus one permanent accuracy. So Mara lost luck but gained accuracy, which is useful. It's not as useful for sword masters, obviously, because we don't really. Swords are pretty accurate weapons to begin with. But yeah, usually if you roll really high on this, you can potentially get a new game plus or get a second hunt back to back, which is a little dangerous. But unfortunately, since we have the guidepost, all that would happen is we would actually have to draw a second settlement event. So not exactly what you want. Anyway, so that is all taken care of. We need to go ahead and add to the timeline. We're on year 11 now, which means bad stuff. So let's go ahead and pull up the bad stuff. Timeline. Year 11, we have the Regal Visit, the Bone Witch, and the Gorm Climate. The Bone Witch is going to be the biggest issue. I've mitigated some of the issue because I took someone that's deaf and who is sane, but pretty much some of our best characters can potentially get some bad debuffs at this point. But let's go ahead and do the Regal Visit first. The Regal Visit can also potentially screw us, so look forward to that, I guess. Let's pull up story events, the Regal Visit. So this is when the hand shows up and says hi. Everything we can roll on this is bad, by the way. Every single one. The hand strides into the settlement, the survivors' thoughts vanish as they fall to their knees, struck dumb by its glorious, incomprehensible presence. Add the hand to the timeline, which I've done already. It's in 2 years from now, and he does an inspection. Now, we do have the guidepost, so if we roll a 5, 6, or 7, we actually can get a free weapon mastery, which is really, really useful. That's what actually I rolled on my previous, well, on the videos that I had to scrap because I forgot about King's Curse. So I'm expecting to roll horrible now. If I roll high, yeah, if I roll high, we'll have our highest experience character get knocked unconscious potentially. If we roll low, we'll lose Ant Lantern Oven and get four people knocked unconscious. And the middle one is we will lose all resources in our settlement storage and minus one population. So really the middle of the road, if we roll a four, that's the worst. The rest of it's not terrible. So yeah, we can work, we might be able to work on it. So let's go ahead and roll 1d10 and see what we get. One. Well, that takes care of that. In one swift motion, the hand draws its sword, cleaving the lantern oven and four survivors asunder. Suffer -1, -4 population. Return the lantern oven to the innovation deck. Challenge the hand to avoid this loss. Okay. Well, let's go ahead and handle the skip next hunt is no longer applies for Yorihime because secretive has worn off by now. So I get to pick four people to go ahead and get. It's either that or I fight him. And honestly, I don't really want to fight him right now. I'm actually fine with losing Lantern Oven. Lantern Oven is usually pretty useful. I mean, you can make scrap swords with it, but I don't need scrap swords anymore. The only swords I really care to make right now are black swords, and that doesn't require heat. In fact, the only things that require heat right now are scrap swords, scrap daggers, rainbow katanas, and monster tooth necklaces. The only thing out of that list I would even potentially even look at is Monster Tooth Necklace, so I'm not that concerned about it. So yeah, I am fine with losing Lantern Oven. If anything, it could potentially give us an opportunity to get Hands of Heat event to trigger. So we lose Lantern Oven, which sucks, but it's not the end of the world. This also will remove Scrap Smelting and Cooking from the deck, which actually shrinks our deck down a little bit, which is fine. So yeah, I'm okay with that. I do need to pick four people to be knocked unconscious, so let's go ahead and handle that right now. I'm fine with Yorihime being knocked unconscious. I'm not taking her on this next hunt anyway. Who here has Burning Ambition? I'll have Mara be hit. It doesn't do anything to her. Anyone else have Burning Ambition? I know somebody does. Kangara does. So I pick Mara, Kangara, Yorihime, and I need to pick one more person. For those who don't remember, Burning Ambition is a fighting art that prevents you from having to skip hunts. So, you'll never have to skip hunts. So, even being knocked unconscious, they'll still keep fighting. Anyway, also, Yoma should have recovered by now. Yoma got knocked unconscious because of the rivalry. And you know what? Let's go ahead and just knock her back unconscious. There you go. So Yorihime, Yomu, Mara, and Kangara were the casualties, and we lost Lantern Oven, which removes cooking and scrap smelting from our innovation deck, which is fine. Now the only other thing that Lantern Oven does besides provide heat is it does give departing survival, so I'll go ahead and remove that. So there you go. So now we only gain three. All right. Not the best result. Now, if I had gotten the guidepost events where you get to pick, get a free weapon mastery, the way that works is you essentially get the innovation, and you'll never have to lose it because the person that it's just the person that taught that gave you the innovation is not a seller. The way it works is whenever you have mastery, you get the actual innovation. That's why we have this innovation called Sword Mastery. And if you ever lose the person that has the sword mastery, you do lose the innovation. But in this case, we're just getting the innovation. It's not tied to anyone, so there's no potential way of losing it. And if I had gotten that, I would have picked, of course, Fist and Tooth Mastery, because that would mean I get every, what would that would do would be no one would have mastery, Fist and Tooth Mastery, but since we have the innovation, it would give everyone specialization, which would allow people to get back up. But we didn't roll that, so I'm not going to worry about it. Anyway, enough rambling. So, next step. So, we've already started bad. We rolled a one, which is good. You know, because that's normal for me. Let's go ahead and do the Bone Witch. Let's knock that out. So let's go to the Bone Witch. We've seen the picture already. So all non-deaths or returning survivors gain 3 insanity. Kangara is deaf. That's why I kept her deaf, so she wouldn't become insane. Everyone else, unfortunately, are going to get 3 insanity. Okay. And all insane returning survivors have to endeavor at the Bone Witch. So we're going to end up spending 3 endeavors to do this. And if we roll poorly, we'll get the Bone Witch again. So let's go ahead and do that. All right. I'm going to be doing the order of the tabs. Kangara doesn't apply because she doesn't have to endeavor there. So I'm going to roll 3d10 and we'll see what we get. Okay, good news. We do not have to add the Bone Witch. If we had rolled 4 or less, we would have to add the Bone Witch 3 years from now. We don't have to worry about that. The only way we can potentially get the Bone Witch again is whenever, I think it's year 12, we can potentially get Hands of Heat again next the year after. And since we don't have a Lantern Oven, there's a potential we could get the Bone Witch again. But at this point, we're actually doing really good. So Tenchi and Momiji get the opportunity to learn Extra Sense. Momiji already knows Extra Sense, so I'm not going to worry about that. Yumiko, what's going to end up happening is if the settlement has the guidepost innovation, the Bone Witch wanders over to it. The settlement is transfixed by a sense of danger effortlessly. The witch plucks the weapon from the ground, archive the guidepost innovation. As a consolation, she offers to teach something, settlement something in exchange for one bone. If you spend one bone, nominate 4 survivors, they gain the Monster Claw style fighting art. So unfortunately, I don't get this plus 2 insanity, plus 1 understanding thing, which would have been useful. Instead, we get this thing instead. I believe that's how it works. Let me look. That's usually how I treat it. The settlement is transfixed. I guess you do both in this case. I'm just checking. Sorry, I'm gonna take, let's see, King Step. Yeah, I think you just get it. I think you do it instead of it. So I'm gonna assume that. I mean, honestly, this is, if I'm correct, then it's fine. If I'm wrong, I just handicap myself a little bit. So I'm not gonna worry about it. Anyway, we lose guidepost. I'm not gonna spend the one bone. I don't care about it. Tenchi, on the other hand, has a potential to learn the extra sense fighting art. I need to roll 1d5 to see how many bone resources it cost. I don't think I have enough bone to even do it. Only one bone. Okay. How many bones do we have? We actually have plenty. So you know what? I'm gonna go ahead and use this stout vertebrae. And I'm gonna have Tenchi learn the extra sense fighting art. I don't really need Defender, so we're just gonna go ahead and take extra sense. So now Tenchi can dodge twice per round, which makes her an even better tank. So really good stuff. Bone Witch is gone. We don't have to add it anymore. Let me check the timeline to make sure she's not been added by accident. Nope, she's good to go. All right. So the only way we can potentially year 13, we can potentially get the Bone Witch back, but that's depending on what choice I make for conviction. By the way, the only principle we can get in this playthrough is conviction. So anyway, the guidepost does provide departing survival, so we do lose that. We lose the guidepost, and that is it. Okay, so takes care of all of that. I'm pretty happy about how that went for the most part. We do have 3 endeavors left. We did get extra sense out of that. So yeah, I mean the Bone Witch does provide useful things. Anyway, at this point, we do need to do one more thing for the timeline. We have Gorm Climate, which of course is going to add Gorm Climate next year. So let's go ahead and add that. And let's go ahead and roll a 1d10 to see if we have to lose Negretto again. We lose Negretto again. I'll go ahead and pull it up just so you guys can see it again, but I think you guys have gotten the gist of it. Yep, it's either we lose all resources or I have to dismantle an innovation. Like I said, it says dismantle an innovation, which is really weird. Like, how do you dismantle something like language or freaking Inner Lantern, which is just a purely spiritual thing, or Symposium for all that? Yeah, it's weird. We're gonna go ahead and lose Negretto again, which sucks, but not much we can do about it. Which means we lose that survival limit again. And that is it. Okay. We have three endeavors left. We definitely want to go ahead and innovate. So let's go ahead and spend a monster bone, monster organ, and unfortunately, we'll have to spend this jiggling lard. I'm just taking a look at a few things to see if we actually need. No. At this point, we need freaking like stout hides. So, yeah. Go ahead and drop those, and we'll spend one endeavor to go ahead and innovate. We have 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 cards. We do have Symposium, so we roll 4d14, and we'll see what we get. We roll duplicates, of course. 1d, 4d14. Yeah. 7, 8, 9, 11. All right. 7 is family, 8 is partnership, 9 is shrine, 11 is settlement watch. All right, so that's a lot of stuff that's not useful. Like really, that's not great at all. I mean, I can go for family, but I don't really need it. I think I might just grab settlement watch again. I don't like it. Like this is all these are this is really bad. I didn't get anything good. I need drums badly so I can get rid of the freaking disorders that we have, but not much we can do about it. So I'll tell you what, we'll 7, 8, 9. And it seems to be always like numbers together, which is really weird. Anyway, shrine is somewhat useful. You can give yourself additional armor when you depart. Though armor is really not going to be a big issue for us because, yeah, we've been relying purely on just raw damage. Also, getting shrine would get us sacrifice, which is not useful at all. I mean, technically, it is useful because we can't permanently lose anyone, so I guess you can knock a bunch of people unconscious to potentially get stuff to happen, but, the only thing that's useful out of this is a 50% chance to push the watcher back on the timeline. But that's not useful at all. So yeah, I don't want shrine. So you know what? Let's grab settlement watch and hopefully we'll do better next year for a actual useful innovation. Unfortunately, there's really nothing we can use the settlement watch with because I think everyone has plus one strength. Well, actually, no, not everyone has plus one strength. Momiji does it. But everyone has fighting arts at this point. So there's that, I guess. All right. Well, we got that, I guess. Anyway. So, we got two endeavors left and not much to spend them on. I think I'm gonna probably go ahead and go for some get some additional understanding. So I'm gonna go ahead and use it on Momiji here, and we'll hopefully get some good things out of that. Probably not. So I'm gonna go ahead and roll 1d10. Momiji's gonna go ahead and do an augury. She gets plus one survival, and we lose one resource and gain one understanding. So I'll go ahead and do that. She's almost to getting insight. All right. So that's all of our endeavors. I don't think there was really anything else I care to work on. No, there really wasn't. Okay. So at this point, with the resources that we have, I'm gonna go ahead and get ourselves another Dryadacanthus because we need to restock on that. There you go, and we'll give it to Tenji. There you go. All right. That's about it. Is there really anything else I care to get? We have a lot of organs, but since we lost Negretto, I'm gonna go ahead and wait to spend those. I think think that'll be a smart decision. We do have a Gorm brain, so I mean, we could potentially get Negretto back, but since we're going to be hunting a Gorm anyway, it doesn't really matter. We have enough resources to at least get another innovation next year, so we can do that. Actually, no, we gotta remember the timeline here. Next year is Principal Conviction. What this means is there's a 50% chance we're going to lose all of our resources. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and actually start spending what we have. We can get some monster grease easily enough. Anything else I don't really care about? I could have gotten a stone circle. That would have been smart, but I went ahead and went for auguries instead because I didn't think ahead. All right, whatever. Does the heart really not have any use? No, it's used for a Gorn. What's a Gorn do? All non-death survivor, knockdown survivors stand and gain plus one to all hit locations. Okay. Kind of interesting, I guess. Well, we actually can go ahead and just do Gorm Kimmy stuff. And get some potions. So you know what? Let's do that. We have to spend two organs to do that, and we have plenty of organs. So yeah, let's go ahead and do that. So we have it's 1d10 plus 1d10 for each Gorm Kimmy innovation. We have three Gorm Kimmy innovations right now, so it's going to be 4d10. So 4d10. That's 16. That gets us a wisdom potion. So let me go ahead and discard these and get ourselves a wisdom potion, which is not the potion I want. Actually, wait, it might be. Play the showdown with the top card of the hit location deck revealed. That's actually kind of interesting. And it's actually, I mean, I could put it on her if I want to. So why not? So yeah, let's go stock up on potions. Let's see what we get. We might get lucky. We got a Gorm brain, which can be used to potentially get yourself a special innovate, but the only strange resource that we had was the was potentially. Well, actually, these might be strange resources. I don't remember if they are, though. So I'm not going to assume. Whatever. I'm going to go ahead and just get ourselves another potion, hopefully. 4d10. Okay, 35. That's a lot better. 35 gets us a life elixir. Awesome. That's actually really useful. Life Elixir. Each showdown, the first time you would die from a severe injury, ignore that injury. It doesn't protect you from severe injuries, it just protects you from the ones that potentially can kill you. So, good stuff there. Alright, and we have enough for one more, because the meaty rib could be a bone or an organ, so let's go ahead and just do those. And we'll get ourselves, let's see what we get. 33. That will get us another life elixir. So we got two now. So that's actually pretty useful. Being able to protect yourself from, death is definitely not a something to sneeze at. So let's see. All right, so let's go ahead and give don't really need it on her. There we go. We'll just give it to her. Everyone's gonna have stinky gear. Now, having stinky gear does have some disadvantages, but it's gonna be okay. This leaves us with a bone and a scrap, which we could use to get a monster tooth necklace, but we lost the lantern oven, so that ain't happening. We can make ourselves a skull helm. now give some additional defense. So you know what? Let's get ourselves a skull helm. Now the reason I'm spending all these resources is because we're potentially going to lose all of them anyway. So, and if we do lose like a certain number of resources, we will get some benefit out of it, but we have enough scrap laying around that we can easily get that to happen. So there you go, skull helm. So that'll give everyone at least a little bit of defense. Okay, that is it for that. Okay, so we need to go on a hunt. We still have the hunter's heart. I'm not going to use it yet, obviously. We're going to go ahead and hunt another Gorm. Speaking of the Gorm, I'm just going to go ahead and point out what a level 2 Gorm would put you through. So when you re once you arrive at the showdown, each survivor has to roll 1d10. If you roll low, you can potentially there's a high chance that you can get collapsed lung. There's also a chance you can just leave and not even show up to the showdown. You can also potentially get all your armor taken from your waist and put on your head, which is really weird. And then there's a chance that you can get frenzy brain trauma and stuff like that. It's all bad. Getting there is not too bad, but when you finish in the aftermath, you have to do a blind exit, which because the reason what's happening is you're fighting essentially in this like disgusting location with like acidic mist and things like that. And when you leave, there's a chance you can get permanent debuffs. There's a chance that you can get a disorder, one of which will prevent you from hunting Gorms and Phoenixes for that matter. There's a chance that you can get acid palms and another debuff, which acid palms is really good if you're going hand to hand, but we're not. And there's a 10% chance that you could potentially get legendary lungs, which is a secret fighting art, which is you can only get from the butcher. But yeah, if you're playing this, not seven samurai with hero mode, this is not the end of the world. You can just send, not your strongest characters, but you can send at least, some fodder with really good gear to fight the level 2 Gorm. And if they survive, great. And if they get some debuffs, that's not a big deal. You just okay, keep sending them until they're to get some extra loot. But in the case of we're stuck with the same seven people, these debuffs will murder us. It's just not a viable option. And I'm not even gonna go over freaking Final March. That's for level 3s, and it's terrible. You could potentially get some Gormite, but it's not great. You can get some unique secret arts and all that nonsense, but really, it's not worth it. Anyway, with all that said and done, let's go ahead and get ready for a departure. I think I'm gonna go ahead and send the usual group because they've been doing rather well, and so far we've been doing well, fantastic, really. Okay. So Kangara's maxed out on courage, which is good. She got to avoid the blindness, which is all right, I guess. For right now, I'm gonna leave her with the injuries. When I originally played this, I used the Hunter's Heart immediately and removed all injuries, but I think I'm gonna save that till the end, so I can potentially heal up my best characters, so they're at 100%. Anyway, so we're gonna go on a hunt, the usual. We're gonna go ahead and send the usual group. So Kangara, Yumiko, Momiji, and Tenshi. We're kind of just focused on getting as much as we can at this point. All right, herb gathering is set up. Gear wise, we get to make a few adjustments. Kangara now has 4 armor in the head. She's supposed to be healed by now. Tenshi's gonna get 2 insanity and 4 armor in the head. Momiji should be good to go. Like that. Oh, and Momiji now has regal gauntlets. So I should have actually upped that to 5. In fact, I should have done that for the Gorm fight. I completely forgot. And then for Yumika, she has that. Our max survival is 8. We definitely have enough departing survival to do this, so. Oh, actually, Kangara doesn't. The departing survival right now is 2. So that is it for that. And she doesn't have any items that actually increase survival gain. Anyway, so that's all taken care of. Let's go ahead and get started. Sorry if I'm going a little slow. I just wanted to go ahead and be very thorough in my explanations. Anyway, so the main things here is we need to do a 1d7 and see what we get. We are hunting a level 1 Gorm. Unfortunately, Gorms are going to be probably the main thing we're going to be fighting for the rest of our lives. That's okay. Beats fighting antelope. We can't even fight antelope for the most part because of the insanity issues that we have. I mean, I don't think we can permanent we won't permanently die, but it's still pretty annoying. Anyway, Morning Bowl. You approach the fresh corpse of a Gorm. The survivors must choose to steer clear or go near. If we steer clear, we all suffer 3 brain event damage, or we can get ambushed with the Gorm having +1 damage. As much as I would love to go ahead and just start the fight, I think I'm just going to go ahead and steer clear. So we're going to all take 3 brain event damage, which unfortunately is going to affect Kangara. Remember, you can't suffer brain traumas or severe injuries during the hunt phase. Anything that says event damage, it can't cause injuries. Anyway, that's all been taken care of. All right. And next, we get herb gathering. Everyone gets +1 survival for hitting the herb gathering spot. So we'll go ahead and get that taken care of. All right. And let's go ahead and do our standard herb gathering again. So I'm just going to roll 3d10 a bunch of times. 3d10. Duplicates, so 0, 15, 21 in total, and then 38. 38 should be enough to at least get us something. Yep, it gets us +1 survival and a fresh acanthus. So let's go ahead and grab ourselves a fresh acanthus. And where's resources? There it is. Awesome. All right, so we'll at least get another herb. All right, after that, oh, I also completely forgot to use an endeavor at the war room. That's my bad. But that's okay. We'll just push on. Anyway, we need to do another 1d7, so we'll go ahead and do that. 1d7. 1. Monsters. Gorm. 1. Flat Earth. Survivors lose their quarry's trail in a field of stone faces, so badly crushed by the passing blah blah blah. Roll 1d10. Okay. 7. Distracted, move the Gorm 1 space away from the survivors on the hunt board. So it goes right there. Okay, that's all taken care of. Next is going to be Momiji. Let's go. Yeah, we'll go ahead and just do the D100 right now. So we want D100, 66. Well, that's a safe sounding number. All right, 66, all the way down here. Forbidden word. There's a great rush of air followed by a booming voice. A word is spoken in an unknown language by an inhuman voice. Just for an instant, the survivors understand. All non-death survivors gain +1 understanding and suffer 1 brain event damage. Insane non-death survivors also gain 1 random disorder. All right. Well, that sucks. So let me take a look at that again. Yeah, +1 understanding, +1 and a brain damage first. So, understanding, brain damage, understanding, which triggers insight, brain damage, and Yumiko gets +1 understanding. I'm gonna go ahead and roll 1d10 for Momiji's insight. She unfortunately only got a 2, which is bad. All right, insight 2. Reroll 1 hunt event result this hunt phase. Okay. Don't think that matters much at this point. And then we need to roll a bunch of disorder. So I'm going to roll 3d46 and the order of the tabs above. So 3d46, 34. 34 is stark raving. You are always insane, regardless of your insanity. Freedom awaits those pushed this far beyond the breaking point. Okay, that's not bad. Stark raving. All right. Next is 29. Narcissistic. There is nothing in the world more beautiful than yourself. You may not wear armor at the head location. If you're wearing armor at the head location, when you gain this disorder, archive it. So that's actually kind of annoying. So make sure I spell that right. Narcissistic. Now, unfortunately, Momiji is wearing head armor, and that means we have to archive this skull helmet. And this will drop her armor down 3 points. Well, at least we got that spare skull helm. All right, and then the last one, 40. Hypersensitivity. You will survive. Your will to survive has become indefatigable. You may dodge one additional time per round. Whenever you are hit by an attack, you must dodge at least once if possible. All right, so this is beneficial, but it does force you to have to spend survival on dodging. Which is fine because I would probably dodge anyway. And if you happen to have what do you call it? Extra sense, that would mean 3 dodges per round. Now the good news is since we have such high survival limit, this is actually pretty beneficial for us. Sensitivity. Okay, cool. That's out of all the things she could have suffered, that is not too bad. So yeah, at least we got to see some unique disorders. That's pretty cool. Anyway, that's taken care of. Next, I'm gonna go ahead before we start on the final spot. I'm gonna go ahead and use the lantern and go ahead and do our stuff for that. So once again, I'm gonna go ahead and have Yumiko turn tune. Everyone else will rest. Actually, I'm gonna have Kangara tune as well. She will gain 3 insanity. That makes her insane, but at this point, I need to make sure she doesn't suffer brain trauma. Tenshi is just gonna get survival. Momiji gets survival. Yumiko will get 5 insanity because she has 2 blue affinity. Okay, and then next we need to roll 1d10. Actually, 1 second. Repair. I'm just seeing if I can do anything. Nope, can't. War Room can't do anything for us. It can't repair brain damage. But we can do the storytelling again, so we'll go ahead and dock that out. So 1d10. 3, of course, nothing happens. We get plus 1 survival. Survivors are amused and relax a little. All right, so that means Kangara will be. Well, she's already at max survival anyway, so it doesn't do anything for us. That's fine. Okay, we do need to do the 100 event, so let's go ahead and do that. 146. River. The survivors come to the edge of a river. They must fan out to pick up the trail again. Each survivor may consume from the river and roll on the table below. Roll once more on the hunt event table before moving on the hunt board as you try to find your quarry. Let's see. I'm looking at seeing what I could potentially get from this. Not really anything. You can get dysentery. That's the best result is you can get dysentery. You can potentially get some basic resources, but we don't really care about those. So we're not gonna consume. If you did have things like Binge Eater, you would have to consume, but we don't have to worry about that. Let's go ahead and roll once more on the hunt event table, because we have to. So D100. 34. Crippling misery. Every survivor must roll 1d10. The lowest scoring survivor becomes a straggler. Any straggler is overcome with a crippling misery and loneliness. Suffer 2 brain event damage. I don't think any. Actually, yes, we do. Okay, Momiji's the only one that's not prepared, so this is going to be fun. I'm going to have to do these individually because some people are prepared, which means they add their hunt XP. So, 3, 6, 9. So, 1d10 plus 9. 15 for Kangara. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So, 1d10 plus 10 for Tenshi. 16. Momiji doesn't have it. One. All right, Momiji's a straggler. There's no way there's gonna be ties. Yeah, I'll just roll it for posterity here. Plus 9, 15. So there's ties, but not for the straggler. So Momiji's the straggler. All that's gonna happen to her is she's going to suffer 2 brain event damage. There we go. And that is it. That means we go ahead and get to start our battle here. Once again. So, nothing too bad here. So, let's go ahead and roll 2d21, 19 and 16. Nineteen survivor corpse, 16's an Orvain. Orvain has to be 6 spaces away from all other terrain. So I don't know, like somewhere over there. And of course the survivor corpse has to be 6 spaces away from all terrain. So not a huge deal at this point, but I might loot them anyway just so they c my other characters have something to do. So t 2, 4, 6. All right, so I can put that on top of you. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There we go. So there's the look. There's all of that. All right. And let's go ahead and make ourselves a AI deck. We do have, by the way, the Wisdom Potion active. I did have the blue connection, and we have enough affinities. Play the showdown with the top card of the hit location deck revealed. So I'll be sure to do that. Not that useful against something like the Kingsmen, but for something like this, it's actually somewhat useful. So, 2 and 8. There you go. Just checking something. Okay. And then we need the AI, the hit location deck. There it is. Right. And yeah, we're pretty much ready. I'm gonna go ahead and shuffle this one more time, and then I'm gonna flip this. So there you go. That is the top card. Not too bad. Okay. So, Gorm does go first. So let's go ahead and get that started. Wallop. Closest threat in field of view and range. And that is it. So I'll go ahead and it's just essentially a basic claw attack. So I pick we'll pick Tenshi. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Two D10. Both hit. Both of the head. Tenshi will just tank it, take 2 damage. Not too bad. All right, it is now our turn. So what I'm gonna go ahead and do here is I'm gonna go ahead and have Kangara search the Orvain. That is just enough to get an iron, so I'll go ahead and get that iron, and then I'm gonna go ahead and dash with Kangara, then surge. So one. So I'm gonna go into this survivor corpse here. Take a brain damage for going into it, because that's what survivor corpses do, by the way. If a survivor moves through a space occupied by this terrain, they suffer brain damage equal to the monster level. Not that that's ma gonna matter, because she's about to search it anyway. So I'm gonna go ahead and search it. 6. That gets us 3 insanity and a skull basic resource. So she's now insane. And we do get a skull, which means we get to give someone an insanity, so I'll go ahead and give that to Yumiko. Okay, all that's taken care of. So all the searching's done. I'll go ahead and get the resources for that. Resources, strange. Okay, get ourselves an iron. And we do get ourselves a skull. There we go. All right. Besides that, let's go ahead and continue. I'm gonna go ahead and get Yumiko started. She'll make her 3 attacks as normal. So 3d10. 3 hits. Okay, I'm not gonna look at them right now. Yumiko has 2 strength, sword mastery, mammoth hunting still, so that is 4 strength plus 3 from the weapon, so 7 in total. So 1d10 plus 7. That's a critical hit. Where do I want to apply it? I actually kind of want to apply it to the mandible for the slim chance of getting some courage. I think I'm okay with that. So yeah, let's go for the reason I mean jiggling lard is actually I could do, go for the jiggling lard actually and just eat it. So you know what? Yeah, let's do it. I mean usually I would keep the jiggling lard, but there's a pretty high chance that we're gonna lose all resources anyway, so I'd rather just get the actual benefit from that. So I'm gonna eat it. Get plus 1 courage, plus 3 insanity. Plus 1 courage. Get her insanity up. The reason I keep putting insanity on to Yumiko whenever I have a choice is because of prey. If she's not insane, she can't spend survival. Anyway, I have to pick a location now for the rest of these. I'm gonna go for the mandible next. That's just a regular hit to the mandible. And for the last location, or sorry, a regular wound. That is a critical hit to this. This goes minus 1 accuracy token. And for those who don't remember, Yumiko does crit on 8s and higher. All right, so minus 1 accuracy, not a big deal. I even forgot to remove it from before, so that's fine. It's there. And next, first I get to look at the top card because that card is active. This wisdom potion, that is. So yeah, play the showdown with the top card of the hit location revealed. So I get to see what I'm going into every time, which is nice. Also, Yumiko did wound, by the way. She does have abyssal status, so that does give her another insanity. Next, I'm gonna go ahead and roll 1d10 to see if I keep my point for surging. I don't. Not that it matters. I'll go ahead and make my 3 attacks. So yeah, Yumiko is surging. 2 hits. So one of them is obviously this, and then the other one is that. All right. I get to roll first, so 1d10 plus 7. That's a wound. I'm gonna go ahead and apply it to the goiter. And then I have to go for the rump next, which is a crit. That's exactly what I wanted. So this ignores the wound reaction, which is great, and I do get a random Gorm resource, which might be useful, assuming I roll good, which I probably won't, because I don't seem to do very well on events. So 1d, I think it's 21. 12. 12 gets us the Milky Eye. When this resource is gained, select a survivor to gain plus 3 insanity. Here you go, Yumiko. Okay, so we do get a Milky Eye. And we will add that to that. And just for the keep track of the skull, there we go. All right. And that is it. I'm going to go ahead and move Tenchi. Tenchi has 5 movement. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And, well, actually, we'll move her right there. And then for Momiji, she'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. It is Monster's turn. I do get to see what the top card is. Next card will be Mammoth Maul. Okay. Next card is Infrasonic Roar, all threats. So, and this attack actually affects everybody, even people that are deaf. So that's kind of weird. Anyway, oh, it's because it's infrasonic, I guess. So it's like actual sonic vibrations. So I'm gonna roll 4d10 in order of the tabs above. So 4d10. Yumiko is not affected. Everyone else is. So one brain damage and one damage to the head location. Brain damage, damage. Brain damage, damage. Brain damage, damage. Okay. Full move the Gorn towards the furthest threat. Actually, before that's going to happen, I'm going to go ahead and surge with Yumiko. Oh, speaking of surging, she did wound on that during that surge action, so she does get a survival and an insanity. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and now surge with Yumiko because it is a new round. So 1d10, she keeps the point, and then she's going to roll 3d10 to see what happens. Two hits. So one is that, and the other is that. The reason I'm doing that is because Yumiko can't exactly keep up. So 1d10 plus 7. That is a wound. I will apply it to the tail. And then for the other location, it is another wound which is going to cause a retch. So it's going to go 1, 2. And it's going to retch on Tenshi. Legs. So Tenshi's going to take one wound that bypasses armor to the legs. Okay, that's taken care of. All right, now the Gorm will move towards the furthest threat. And the way I'm going to handle this is actually I'm going to go ahead and dash with Kangara. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then this Gorm's going to go 1, 2, 3. So the reason I dashed forward is because I needed to keep Yumiko in range, because Yumiko only has a 2 movement because of erythemophilia. So, alright. It is now our turn. Because I don't think there was anything else. Nope, there is nothing else. That gets put away. Flip the top card. Alright, I know the next card is Fluorescent Lure. Unfortunately, I can't do quite enough damage to kill him, so that's a thing, I guess. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and move up with Yumiko, and oh, Yumiko did wound with her attacks, by the way, so she does get a insanity. All right, so 3d10. She actually hits on threes now. Yeah, because she's attacking in the blind spot and she has mastery. So three hits. 1, 2. Okay. Let's go ahead and roll. It's a 1d10 plus 6 now because I'm not attacking in the flank. That's a failed a wound. I will go ahead and apply that to. I'll actually apply it to the testes. I don't think I want mammoth hunting. Well, I already have mammoth hunting, so yeah, doesn't matter. All right, next I'll go for the skull. Actually, sorry, next I'll go for the lure. All right, that is exactly a wound to the lure. Level 1 Gorms have 8 toughness, by the way. Okay, and next I'll go for the skull. That's a failed wound to the skull, so at least I don't have to worry about the reaction. Okay, and top card is going to be the trap card, so at least I know that's going to happen. I can't surge because I've already surged this round with Yumiko. What I can do is I can attack with Kangara, though. So yeah, I'll go ahead and do that. Kangara has minus one accuracy, so she hits on sevens, so four attacks. All I need to do is hit once, so 4d10. No hits. I'm gonna go ahead and I'll have I'll surge with Gungara. I want her to take the hit because obviously she actually has the most head armor right now. All right, two hits. One of them's obviously going to be the trap card, so I'm just going to trigger that. Full move the Gorn, blah blah blah. It's going to headbutt and does one. It does one lo damage to the head location. For those who don't remember, the star represents the monster's level. Turn the monster to face the most survivors. All right. It's actually this way. Okay, it's gonna do one brain damage and knock them down. This is not an intimidate action, so it does work. So brain damage, brain damage, knock down, knock down. Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and shuffle this. And we get to see the top card still. So we now know it's Maul. Okay. That is it for this turn, because I want to attack only with Yumiko because she has the highest crit chance. So next turn. Shuffle the deck. Wallop. Closest threat in field of view and range. The only person in field of view that's not a th that's a actual threat is Tenchi. So it's just gonna turn this way. Makes two attacks. Hits on three base because of minus one accuracy, and then Tenchi has like three evasion, so this would hit on sixes, so it's one hit. So 1d6. This hits in the legs for Tenchi. All right, and it's now our turn. They get back up. Because that happened on our turn rather than the monster's turn. Yumiko will go ahead and make her three attacks. 3d10. Two hits. Okay, super dense, not a big deal. All right, we get to roll. It's 1d10 plus 7 again because I am attacking the flank. That's a regular wound. I will apply it to the ridge spine. That goes in for Sonic Roar. And then the Mammoth Maw. That is a successful wound. I'm gonna go ahead and we're okay. You know what? We'll soak it. So this is a wound, which will remove this last card, and then it's going to do retch. So it's gonna go 1, 2. It's gonna hit those two. Kongara is gonna take a damage to the head. Bypasses armor, so this will knock her down. And then for Tenchi, it's the arms, bypasses armor. Okay, it's now our turn. Or sorry, I'm gonna go ahead and search. Well, Yumiko gets an insanity because of Abyssal Sadus, and then I'm gonna spend a survival to go ahead and dash, or not dash, but I'll surge. She keeps the point. 3d10, perfect hit. So I do get the sharpened blade, and it's three hits. By the way, the top card is that. I should have looked at that first. Okay. So at this point, it's 1d10 plus 11 because I get the sharpened blade. That is a regular wound. I will apply it to the tail that kills the monster. All right, and that's the battle. Pretty straightforward. Not a big deal. Kangara is going to level up. Tenchi gets experience. Momiji gets experience. Yumiko levels up. So let's go ahead and do the age events for them. Also, Momiji's curse is going to activate, by the way. So we do know about that. All right, so story events, age. 13 is a random fighting art. And for Yumiko, it's a fighting art. Okay. I'll roll 2d47 in the order of the tabs above. So 2d47. 21 and 36. Right, 21 is acrobatics. When you are adjacent to the monster, you may spend your movement to place your move action, sorry, to place your survivor on any other space adjacent to the monster. That's actually pretty neat. So that's 21. That was for Kangara, so she gets acrobatics. And then for Yimiko. Looks like we got Seasoned Hunter. Seasoned Hunter, whenever a random hunt event result is 11, 22, 33, 44, 55, 66, 77, 88, 99, and or 100, the event revealer gains plus one understanding and plus one courage. Neat. So as long as she's on the hunt, the event revealer will get this benefit. It's not her, but it's the event revealer. Because that's how it's worded. Some of these are kind of weird sometimes. Anyway, I have Abyssal Sages, Mammoth Hunting, and Tough. I have to drop one to get this. Well, I have to drop one. I don't get an option there. So Seasoned Hunter. So we'll drop Mammoth Hunting and get Seasoned Hunter. There you go. Good stuff there. And let's go ahead and roll a 1d6 and see what we get on good ol' Momiji. Where is it? King's Curse. There it is. So let's roll 1d6. We already have the legs. So we'll roll again. That is the body. With a horrific crunch, your rib cage bursts from your chest and warps drastically, puncturing your internal organs. Your open stomach pours acid over your exposed innards. You double over, vomiting foaming chunks everywhere. Finally, you stand, drawing no breath, but somehow alive. Gain the Regal Placard Rear Gear Card, and place it in your gear card now. The other returning survivors suffer 3 brain event damage. Your body seems mo to move on its own. Gain the King Step Secret Fighting Arts. So King Step, I'll go ahead and drop Monster Claw style for King Step. So there you go. We got ourselves a secret fighting art out of that. And I'll bring up King Step again just so you guys know what it is. It was something I kind of ignored because I didn't go for it when I fought the Kingsman. Everyone else does take 3 brain event damage. So Kangara is sane again. Tenchi's insane no matter what, and Yumiko is now down to that. All right. Actually, I forgot to give Yumiko one insanity for the last wound. So there you go. That's taken care of. All right. So yeah, we're down to the head and the waist left. Which is a little weird because you can't archive the Regal Helmets. So I think that's gonna override his her disorder. Oh well. Anyway, yeah, so that's taken care of. We'll get the Regal Placard. Which is just literally chest armor, so there you go. Now she's even tankier than before. She'll definitely be good and ready for the hand at this rate. All right, let's go ahead and roll for loot because we need to do that still. And if we get to keep the loot, great, but it's a 50-50 chance, and with my luck, I'll roll a 1. So let's roll 4d21. This is Gorm stuff, by the way. I should have stated that before rolling, but I always do Gorm first. So there you go. So 1, 2, 7, and 16. Acid Gland. Dense Bone. Jiggling Lard. And Stout Hide. There we go. We can at least maybe be able to make some new equipment. Assuming I don't lose it. There you go, Stout Hide. Okay, that was weird. All right, Lard. Dense Bone. There it goes. I was hoping I didn't lose connection. There we go. And then finally, the est gland. We did get quite a bit of resources, but like I said, there's a pretty good chance we're going to lose it all. Anyway, let's go ahead and do 40-21 for basic resources. Thirteen, 14, 15, 17. 13, let's see. It was 13, 14, 15, which are all monster hides, and then 17's a monster organ. There we go. So yeah, that's we got 12 resources out of that. All right. Well, I'm gonna go ahead and call this a video. I'm the Depressed Eeyore, and when we come back, we'll see if we actually keep all this fancy stuff that we just got. Oh, by the way, we did get Negretto. Let's do that. There you go. There we go. Everything's back to normal. All right. Depressed Eeyore, Kingdom Death Monster. See you guys later.